So IBM has released another series of quantum chips. So this is what we're going to talk about today. The first one is this 1,000 qubit chip called the Condor, and basically this is a sort of next generation chip compared to the previous Osprey, which we did a video on almost exactly a year ago. So the previous chip was a 433 qubit chip, but this one is a 1,121 qubit machine.
The world's largest quantum computing processor. No claps, all right.
It's got basically the same kind of geometry. It's in a honeycomb configuration. It's got a 50% increase in qubit density.
Now going to five levels of superconducting metal layers.
But otherwise, basically, the performance in terms of characteristics, which things like quantum volume and T1 times T2 times, are similar to previous chips. If you think that basically what IBM is trying to do is to increase the number of chips by a factor of two each year, actually, if you look at their roadmap, it's pretty much the end of the road for this kind of strategy. If you look at what's been happening in the last few years, they're basically going from creating chips with larger numbers of qubits, but they're switching tack into looking at more parallelized
By the
kind of
end of
systems. So
2024,
they're looking at making smaller chips, but like joining them together in a more kind of modular fashion. And so this IBM system, Quantum System 2, is supposed to be basically this architecture. Now, again, there's very little information on what actually this entails. All I could really find was this YouTube video where they literally have this hand joining together this model Quantum System 2 Lego bricks, and that's about pretty much the only information that I can see. So I don't really know what actually this system is actually doing. If you have a modular architecture, if you're actually going to join together quantum computers, now I assume you want to do things like transfer quantum information, have entanglement between the sub-quantum computers, but there's no information along these lines. So I really don't know actually what actually that actually entails. Okay, and apart from that, basically what they talk about is how quantum is now entering this age of so-called quantum utility, where you can actually do meaningful kind of calculations using quantum computers that are actually not just demonstrations of quantum supremacy or quantum advantage. In 2019, there was also an experiment by Google to show that you could do a quantum calculation that actually a classical computer could not do for 10,000 years, right? So that was the first demonstration of so-called quantum supremacy or quantum advantage. Quantum advantage is the more politically correct way to say it. But basically, the point here is that such demonstrations actually had no practical use, right? So this kind of random quantum circuit is not useful. It's just purely for the demonstration of quantum advantage. Now we're entering an age where quantum computers might actually do something which a classical computer can't do, and it's actually useful for something.
And earlier this summer, we published a paper that shakes this up. We call it the utility paper. We showed that quantum can tackle problems beyond brute force classical computing methods, and that's what we mean by quantum utility.
The third kind of release that they have is this so-called Heron chip. So this is only a 133 qubit machine. But the main innovation here is that this one has like tunable couplers. And the importance of this is that basically in all these superconducting qubit systems, crosstalk is like a major issue, right? So basically that means that if you have qubits that are near to each other, they can interact in some uncontrollable ways. And so basically having these tunable couplers is a way of reducing crosstalk. So in fact, this kind of thing has been investigated in the science community for some time. And for example, this is a architecture done by the Martinez group. Basically, the idea here is to not only have these qubits that of course have these couplings that allow you to do two-qubit gates, but it allows you to actually just turn them off actually as well. Previously, basically how you control your two-qubit gate is to put the qubits out of resonance with the communicating channel and then turn on and off the gates in this way, not actually directly turn the couplings off, but as you can see from this paper over 10 years old, you can actually turn off the couplings using this kind of technology too. This is basically the new development for this kind of chip. In this case, basically the number of qubits is very similar to that of the Eagle processor. I believe we did a video on that as well about 2 years ago. So the architecture itself is very similar, has marginally larger number of qubits, but the performance actually increase is about 3 to 5 times. And I'll talk a little bit more about exactly what way this performance increase is actually manifest. So the only real hard data that I could actually find was this particular paper. So this is an archive preprint that was released just last month. And basically what this paper is about a new benchmarking protocol. And what they actually do here is to use this new benchmarking protocol to compare the previous Eagle processor with the new Heron processor, which is the one that's just released now. And as you can see down the bottom here, they compare it using this new metric and they find it's about 3 times better than the old one. And hence, I think this figure of 3 times better is coming from this kind of measure. Now, it's interesting to see the motivation of why they are actually talking about this. If you actually look in one of the paragraphs in the introduction, basically they start to say that quantum volume is not a very good metric after all. In fact, I think a couple of years ago, IBM was pushing quantum volume as a very good metric. But if you actually read what they are writing now, they're saying that quantum volume is not a good representative number of the overall quality. For example, in superconducting qubits, the largest quantum volume is 512. So that's their old record from, I believe, last year. But in ion traps, it's like 500,000. That's 19 qubits. And just to remind you what this measure of quantum volume is, basically what this is a randomized kind of benchmarking quantum circuit, and it becomes like a fully entangled quantum circuit. So what you do is to look at the probability outcomes, and what you want to see are the correct kind of outcomes that are happening with some probability more than 2/3 of the time. And the actual quantum volume metric is the largest quantum circuit that involves, say, d qubits and has a depth of d, where this benchmarking still actually works. And it's interesting to see that the records for quantum volume, conveniently, I believe IBM is backtracking on this quantum volume metric now, because basically other groups and other technologies are pretty much blasting them out of the water using this particular metric. So now they want to turn to a different metric where perhaps they have some kind of advantage. So what is this actual new benchmarking method? So it goes something like this. I'll just give you a quick idea of what it is. So you have a original quantum circuit, say, to the left there, which is your fully entangled quantum circuit. That's part A there. And then what you do is you actually break it into disconnected parts so that it's now no longer a fully connected circuit, but it's actually a bunch of disconnected 1 and 2 qubit gates, right? And then you go and do randomized benchmarking, that's D in this figure, and essentially this is just going to do your benchmarking on just isolated 2-qubit and 1-qubit gates, right? And then you get fidelities for those two disconnected circuits, you multiply them all together, and then you get this so-called LF there, which is this layer fidelity, which is basically like the combined fidelity of these two layers combined, right? Finally, you can convert this to an error per layered gate by just rescaling it. It's 1 minus the layer fidelity to the power of 1 over the number of 2-qubit gates. And then that gives you your error per layered gate. To me, this actually just looks like a kind of geometric mean of 1 and 2-qubit gates. To me, this doesn't really capture the full entanglement of the circuit. But this is what they're pushing now. And so using that particular metric, they can find that their Heron processor is much better than their previous ones. Okay, so that's pretty much, I believe, it. Overall, I think my take on this is that they don't really seem to have very much performance improvement. In fact, most of the performance improvement, if this is basically what they had last year, comparing like the Eagle versus Osprey, so that's like 2022, versus 2021. They had a lot of performance improvement there, but actually in terms of performance improvement, I believe we're not really seeing that much. They've got, yes, they got more qubits, but I believe it sounds like their quantum volume is actually exactly the same, particularly if you look at basically what they say in their own paper. The world record for superconducting qubits is still 512. I'll turn it over to you guys. What's your impression?
So that's nothing that they increase the number of qubits, but computations are not light years of speed. I imagine having more qubits, they can code more advanced algorithms. Is that a good way of thinking?
Yeah, you'd hope so, that you have a larger machine. That's what happens with normal computers, right? You get you buy a new chip and it does faster and better things, right? In my mind, I can't see it actually doing anything better than the old chips, because you could easily run basically the same quantum volumes on the last chips, which actually only involve 9 qubits, right? The quantum volume of 9 qubits.
From what I read, like 1,000 qubits like should be like more than enough to like run a reasonable Shor's algorithm, for instance.
Yes.
It's like one of the most popular benchmarks. We run Shor algorithm. That's what you want to publish.
Yeah, exactly.
Or maybe you don't.
Yes, exactly. But I guess the usual thing is that you need quantum error correction for Shor's algorithm. And so if you include that, then it's more than millions of qubits.
Yeah.
Assuming you break, you know, what they did was to break up the circuit and do some analysis on parts of the circuit and get some error. If I connect up the circuit and do the same thing, would the error be the same or different?
It'd be different, yeah. 100% different. 100% different, yeah.
That's only, you said it, I was just like, yeah, if I'm going to do an experiment, I think I better look at the whole thing,
yeah,
and know what my error is than breaking it up in parts and looking in different parts and say, okay, this is the error I get. I don't know.
Yeah, to me, it just looks like just a sort of an average 2-qubit error.
Yeah.
Calculated a bit differently, but if you're going to break up the circuit, I don't know. It's not like a fully connected kind of circuit, right? It'll be interesting to see. Okay, they introduced this new metric because maybe Quantinuum was blasting them out of the water, right? Maybe Quantinuum can give their EPLG metrics and see whether which quantum computer works better, right? This is a metric, right? But is it meaningful? I don't know. I think quantum volume is still more meaningful, actually.
Next to roadmap, they are going to combine this chip. They are not going to increase the size, the number of the qubits, but they are maybe just joining different such qubits all together.
Yeah, so I think that would be very interesting. If they can do that really well, then that's... Yeah, that's a big advancement.
So
yeah.
In terms of like their achievement, this Condor is the biggest one.
Mm.
So that now they can combine different.
Right.
Chips,
so. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. So in 2024, I think they combining what these Heron chips together. I think it seems like so. Yeah, it'll be interesting to see the performance. All right, let's leave it there. Thanks for watching. See you for the next video.